Ola, O-L-A, M, that's for Mildred, that's why people call me Millie, Rexroat, R-E-X-R-O-A-T. I was married to a McDonald.
Was he old McDonald?
No, he was pretty young.
Oh, okay.
But I divorced him sometime later. I don't remember exactly when. Edgemont, South Dakota.
Place of birth.
Argonia, Kansas. Not Texas, as some people have put down. August 29th, 1917. I am 91, and in August I'll be 92. I am Anglo, but I am also Oglala.
And what was your branch of service?
When I was in the service, I was in the Army Air Corps. And since then, they have created the Air Force. And I was a WASP. That's Women Airforce Service Pilots. That's for the WASP.
Oh, very good.
Did you buzz?
Not often. I didn't enlist, except this is different from usual.
Okay.
Because of the fact that we were WASP. We, of course, filled out applications to become a WASP, and so that takes the part, I think, of other people being enlisted.
Okay.
But when we went through our training all the way through and graduated and did not get washed out, they at first were planning, and that was told to us in the information they mailed to us, that on graduation we would be commissioned as second lieutenants. This did not happen because we found out that it took an act of Congress to make this happen. And I don't know why, but Congress did not pass that part of it. So we were not commissioned. And we were just given the title of Women Air Force Service Pilots. We went on to graduate and be sent to different Air Force bases to do whatever work they had for us. I was sent to Eagle Pass, Texas, Air Force Base. And my mission was to tow targets for aerial gunnery. And that was mainly what I did. I did a few ferry trips and a few administrative that consists mostly of taking some ground. We called them ground pounders. It was somebody in the service, usually some officer that was there and needed to go someplace else like Randolph. And they would call on the phone to the WASP barracks and say, we need a pilot. And so whoever answered the phone, or if they were busy, they'd call out and say, they need a pilot, and get down to operations now. And my towing targets was the main part of my duty. And usually we were assigned so that one group was assigned to flying in the morning, and the other group that did not fly in the morning was assigned to flying in the afternoon. And it changed every day. So if you flew in the morning one day, you flew in the afternoon the following day. And they were long mornings and long afternoons.
So when did the morning start?
8 o'clock, I think.
Okay.
As I remember, 8 o'clock, and went through noon, and then you were more or less off flying duty.
Okay. Were there any ranks?
They did not give us ranks, wow. As I mentioned earlier, we were WASP.
So everybody was the
same
level?
And they, I guess everybody at the base, it was explained to them that we were to be treated as officers. At our base, which was Eagle Pass Air Force Base, and our CO was Colonel Hal Bundy, B-U-N-D-Y.
Okay.
He is now deceased. He was one of the COs that liked his WASP, and when I was sent there, there were five from my class that were sent down to Eagle Pass. Most of us did what I was doing, towing targets. A few of them did work like the inspection, flight inspection of aircraft after they had been worked on, like maybe some accident had occurred and it was put back together and pronounced airworthy by whatever person had worked on it. And those would be all enlisted personnel, but very trained and knew what they were doing. And then somebody had to go and test it, test flight. And some of the WASPs were assigned to do that after they had been repaired, after they got a new wing or a new propeller or something of that nature.
When did you, let's go back some, hold on. Let's go back some. Where were you when World War II broke out, and what prompted you to pursue this career or this service?
Well, I was in Washington, D.C., and I was working there for the Army War College, and they didn't have a separate Air Force at that time. But I wasn't really working for anything connected with flying, except that I was interested in that, and I had applied for training at Sweetwater, Texas, which was the main, or I should say the only training base for women in the country. And so I was told that I got a letter, that is. My application was accepted, and that I would be assigned to a class later on and told when to report for training. And so I was. In the meantime, you didn't know when or anything. You just waited to hear from them. And so after I had been waiting about, I don't know, 3 or 4 months, I got a letter, no, it was a telegram, telling me to report for training some date in February 1944, and told me where, and Sweetwater. And it said, upon successful completion of training, you will be commissioned as a second lieutenant.
But that didn't happen.
That's what they said. Right. And it was just a telegram, so it was very short. And, of course, that did not happen.
How did you react when you got the... when you got the telegram? Now, it had been quite a while. Like, World War II broke out in 1941. You didn't go in until 1944. What were you doing during those interim years? Were you at the War College?
I was at the War College for a while in 1943. But I was... working for different government agencies like the U.S. Engineers, and they were building bases, airfields all over Texas and the rest of the country, wherever they could find a suitable place, which usually involved a lot of leveling, grading, and taking out bushes. And then they would build the runways, and a lot of times they were not real good runways like they make now with, like, cement and stuff like that. But there was... they just used what they could get, and sometimes it ended up just being dirt if it was hard enough. And so I worked for them, and that was with the U.S. Engineers, not to be confused with the Army Engineers.
Okay, so you did that prior to, that was at the beginning of the war you were doing that?
I don't remember if it was at the beginning, but probably for 2 or 3 years.
Okay, so then that would take you into the War College time, and then that took you into getting notice about going into the WASP.
Yes.
Okay. So what was your reaction when you got this telegram about being accepted into the program? Do you remember how you reacted? Did you jump up and down?
I was very happy. And then later... after the telegram, we got a letter telling us what we could take and what we would be allowed to wear, and take suitable shoes, and told us we would not get any time off during the training, which was 8 months, and, you know, to proceed accordingly.
Do you remember what the list, some of the things that were that you could take and that you should have with you?
Well, as far as clothing, we were, and our hair, we were not supposed to have hair that come down below our collar, the length of our collar. And so I got mine cut off right away. It wasn't very long, but longer than that. And shoes, they wanted us to have Oxford that laced up and stayed on, because I guess they had had some incidents, like, if you remember penny loafers that almost everybody had, well, they would slide off your feet, but they were comfortable and easy to get into. But one time, one girl had to jump because of an engine fire, and her loafers came off. And she, I think, landed in cactus or something. So that's why that was put into there. But otherwise, we were told we were not going to have any time off, except due to weather, we might have time to go to town once a week, but not to bank on that, because sometimes if it had been raining or for some reason we could not continue our training all week long, then we would have to fly on Saturday and Sunday to make up the time.
Do you want some water? My wife will give you some water to clear your throat.
Yeah, I'm right here.
So you're not getting raspy.
There you go.
If it does any good.
How did your family react to this? Did you tell them you were going to go be a woman pilot? And what did they think?
Oh, my sisters thought it was great. They were both working for war agencies. I don't remember what agencies, in Washington, D.C. And I was living with them part of the time when I didn't have my own apartment. But my mother was totally against it. She didn't want me to do anything that, even though I told her I was not going to really be in combat, she said nevertheless that it was training other people to kill other people, and that's why she objected to it. Okay. Other than the fact that it was dangerous. That's all.
So that was pretty... So your mother considered this a pretty wild thing for you to do.
Yeah, but my sisters were all for it.
So, so you get the telegram, you get the letter, they give you a list of what to take. So... Do you remember when did you actually arrive at the camp to start this training?
In February of 1944.
Okay. And this was in Texas?
Yes, Sweetwater, okay. Texas.
Right. Okay. And so can you recall, give the people who will be listening to this, I was in the Marine Corps and I remember training there in Parris Island. Can you give the listeners an idea of what the average day was like, you know, what time you got up, what the training consisted of, things like that?
6 o'clock reveille, and get up, march over to breakfast, whether you intended to eat or not, which I didn't part of the time. But you had to march over there anyway and be in the formation. And then you came back and you either went to ground school in the morning and flight training in the afternoon, or the other way around. And it changed every day. And that took up the whole day.
And any free time at night? Any free time?
Well, there was free time, but you couldn't go to town or do anything like that. And we had bed check at 9 o'clock. And we had to do all our studying for the ground school, and we had frequent examinations, and we were just given the regular ground school, the same thing that the male cadets had for navigation, weather,
okay,
engines, that sort of thing.
And so now you had never flown a plane before?
No.
And what I mean, you know, this is back in the 30s and 40s, so most people didn't fly. What attracted you about flying that caused you to volunteer for this group?
Well, I had some skills that I was pretty good at, but that consisted of typing and shorthand and other office procedures. And I didn't want to keep on doing that because I felt that I was capable of quite a bit more. This was during the war, and almost everybody you encountered wanted to do something to help the war effort, and I was one of those. So I kept reviewing in my mind, what can I do that will be more than working in an office, taking shorthand and filling out forms and putting them in the mail and such. And I thought, should I join the WAC, which was the Women's Army Corps? And I didn't really want to do that. Should I join the Navy? And I didn't know enough about that. And I didn't really want to do that. And I thought about the Marines, which I did think I would like. And I sent them a telegram, and they answered me to come at once, and I would be enlisted or enrolled or something like that, and I would find out my duties and rank later when I got there. And so I wasn't too anxious to do that. And then I thought, if I had some background of doing something, maybe I could, you know, do something that really made a difference. And that's how I happened to think about I didn't even know how to drive a car. And I thought, if I could do something like fly. So I went out to the airport and found some guys out there that had a flight school. And I told them, I said, hey, can I learn to fly out here? And they said, no. And I said, why not? And so they said, well, in the first place, you're a woman. And in the second place, you're not in the Civil Air Patrol. And I didn't know what that was. And in the third place, unless you are going to be in the WASP, you just can't do it because they had restrictions on almost everything. If a person owned a plane or several planes, like if they had a flying school, they had restrictions on everything they could do, including putting gas in their airplanes. But they said, I said, that's what I'm going to do. I'm going to be a WASP. What is it? And they said, the Women's Air Force Service Pilots. So I said, well, that's what I'm going to do. And so I went and told somebody that's what I was going to do. And they said, well, it costs $6 an hour for solo flight and $8 an hour for instruction. So I said, well, all right. When can I start? So I had a day and a half off each week, Saturday afternoon and Sunday. And that's when I did most of my flying at that same place. And it was required. If you wanted to be in the WASP, they sent you an application and information that you must have 35 hours of flight time before they would accept your application. So that's what you worked for. So every time I went out there to get some more time, and then I'd add it up and see if I was up to 35 yet, and as soon as I got 35 hours, I sent off my application to the director of women pilots. That was Jacqueline Cochran, C-O-C-H-R-A-N. And when it was accepted, I waited for them to tell me to report for duty, and I already told you right. The rest of it.